Good evening. Welcome to Hingham School Committee, December 21st, 2015. Let's call the meeting to order at 7:30 p.m. Item number two, approval of minutes, or 2.1, approval of minutes. Minutes of the school committee meeting held December 7th, 2015. Do I have a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes of the school committee meeting held on December 7th, 2015.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? None. Thank you very much. Item three, questions and comments. Audience comments are always welcomed as agenda items are discussed. The school committee has set aside 15 minutes of this agenda to enable members of the audience to raise questions and make comments on any matter of general concern that is not on the agenda. We have a nice guest.
Hi, my name is Annapolis. And my son, Sean Annapolis, who's in South, just wanted to drop off some Christmas cards and thank you for all the work you guys do. And it is amazing when I watch the meetings, I just think, oh my God, that's just a lot of work, a lot of paperwork. So thank you very much on behalf of all the kids. Have a good holiday.
Great.
And shameless plug, sorry, February 4th, CPAC's having the Shut Up Sisters at the Country Club. So hopefully it won't be a blizzard, but it should be a fun comedy night. And from 6:30 to 7's cocktails, and then the show is after that. So we're going to have a flyer out, and then we'll be giving some more information. I just wanted to get the date out there and firm it up after the holidays, because if we do it now, it'll be like, woo, it's gone after. So that should be coming out very soon. So thank you very much.
Well, what was the title again of it?
It's the Shut Up Sisters, and they're two women who are indeed sisters, and both their children have special needs. And they wrote a book, it's at the public library, and basically it's a comedy routine about, you know, having kids that may be a little different and their joint experiences. And they came about 3 years ago to the Country Club, and it was a really fun night. And, you know, we had staff and teachers and aides. It was a nice mix of the community, and it really, really was funny, because if you don't laugh about stuff like this, you're going to be in trouble. You know? So it should be a really good night. It's February 4th, which is a Thursday. So
good. Now, Diane, while we're here, we know that Dr. Ed Pryor, who is our liaison and chair of our Subcommittee on Special Education, has raved about some of your seminars you've had, events. Do you want to, you have the floor if you'd like to give a shout out.
Okay.
We'll be happy to comment.
Yeah. No, we've had a good start to the year. You know, a lot of things coming up, actually, that we're sort of ramping up for more things. We had some good socials. We had a great speaker. We kind of figure we're trying to shake it up between socials, speakers, and then just ongoing meetings. We're also working with SNAP more closely for some things at the end of the year, like having a big kickoff, having a fun run, which the CPAC used to do, but we're looking at doing it in the Black Rock area so kids can get, in, you know, feedback as opposed to being in the woods, which was a little isolating. So, you know, we've really had great support from Dr. Gallo and Liz, and everybody is, you know, very, very helpful. The teachers are always amazing. If you say we're thinking about something, or, you know, you see a child who might need help, they're really good at kind of getting CPAC together with the parents. So, no, I appreciate everyone's support, and, you know, it's an important, we always say this is our tribe, and it's kind of good to have tribe meetings every once in a while.
And then what is your website, and when do you guys meet all the time?
We usually meet the third Monday of the month, unless there's a holiday, or, you know, that can be tricky because you have a couple of upcoming holidays, so we'll move it as possible for the board. But generally speaking, it is the third Monday. But again, we'll have socials and other things that won't be the Monday meetings. And the website, you can access it through the Hingham Public Schools or this CPAC.com for Hingham. You can get in that way. So
wonderful.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much. Dr. Shire, Dr. Gallo?
On January 11th, we're going to feature our special education and CPAC and SNAP on a superintendent spotlight. So we're going to do the taping on January 11th.
Yes.
And I will be one of the guests, as will Liz and Nate. Nate's last name?
Rand.
Nate Rand. I should have remembered that. And Kerry Nate.
Yes.
I think that's it. So
wonderful. Well, great. Thank you very much. Merry Christmas. Happy holidays. Happy New Year. You can stay, but he has school, so you can leave.
Thank you.
Item 4.0, Superintendent's report. Dr. Gallo.
Yes, I'm going to go through these things fairly quickly. However, they are all in your packet, so you can read the information later. First of all, I'll mention a letter from Garrett Bradley. I think it's in the back of your packet, and it's a congratulations to Plymouth River School and the staff and students there, because they were one of the commended students by DESE this year for last spring's MCAS. Ellen's going to talk about accountability later, but as Garrett says in this letter, Plymouth River was only one of two schools on the South Shore that were commended, and they were commended for their high achievement and the high progress and narrowing the proficiency gap. Second thing I want to mention is the extreme couponing activity. This was an activity that was done last year and then just recently again this year. Activity for the algebra with linear emphasis classes, and the notion, it's modeled after TV show, but the notion is that they take money and collect coupons for a period of months and do a lot of in-class activities that have to do with planning and saving money, and then they go on a shopping spree to Stop and Shop, it was this year. And they had a $500 donation from the high school PTO, and as well, they had an online Fund Me kind of activity, and that raised another $325. So with the total of $825, they were able to turn that into $1,500 worth of food, which was then donated to the food pantry. So there's a letter here in your packet from Sarah Coughlin, and you can read about the details of that. As well, it will be on YouTube again this year. You can actually see last year's YouTube of the actual shopping trip and the carts all filled up. So that's a nice activity. Just today, I received three certificates, and I'll make sure that they get to the proper owners, and the owners aren't even aware of this recognition. But the first one is a certificate of recognition for Mass Recycle, the Southeast Municipal Recycling Council, and is presented to the town of Hingham for leadership in school composting. And you know all of our schools are now into that, and so that's a great award. Similar organization, Mass Recycle Southeast Municipal Recycling Council, certificate of recognition to the town of Hingham for leadership in school recycling. Pass these along. And then the last one is in particular to the high school for leadership in school composting, because they've been at it for a longer period of time than any of the other schools. So we'll pass those along, but that's nice recognition for something that's been very important to us and that has benefited our town and kids in developing good habits early on. Also, just new today, I got an email, and it's in your packet as well, from Julie Robinson at East Elementary School, and they have secured, in conjunction with Holly Hill Farms and with the Whole Foods Corporation, a $2,000 grant, and that is going to be used to put a fence around the East School Garden. East School Garden was moved from right outside the cafeteria area, where we now have the beautiful patio, across the road to near the play fields, and so it's in a more open area and needs to be fenced off. So we're excited about that, and thank you to the donors there, and also to our helpers at Holly Hill Farm. We got just today, and this is a letter with a copy of a check in your packet, $50 donation from Looters, I think you pronounce it, Environmental, and they do lawn work and landscaping and so on in the Hingham area, and apparently their tradition is to make a donation to the local schools in the towns where they have customers. So very unexpected, but very much appreciated. And we have an account, John, right?
Into
the gift account. So we'll find some worthy thing to do with that.
Probably recycling or something green.
Something green would be a good thing to do.
We'll go back into that arena.
Right. I think the other topic I want to talk about a bit, security, I'd like to do under the item, what's the 48-hour item?
Seven.
Because I have something more to add to that. With respect to the budget process update, I did put at your place, but it's also in the packet, a summary of a part of the budget calendar. The budget calendar, of course, is quite dense with lots and lots of dates, but I wanted you to be aware of the things that would be coming up sooner rather than later, and also identify the topics that would be discussed at each of the budget work sessions. So if you can pull that out, and we'll see if I can find it here. So the first thing that will occur with respect to the budget is by Monday the 4th, if not before, you will receive by email a copy of the budget message. And the budget message is a summary of what the budget will include. There are not dollars in that document, but it talks about the process of building the budget and talks about the things that we are recommending as part of the administrative proposal. So that will come to you by email so that you'll have a copy of it prior to the first work session, which is on Thursday the 7th. So in the first work session, we'll do what we call the mainly instructional functions of the budget, and review those, any significant changes in them. These are the ones that have most of the personnel in them. And so we will be, as we go through these in a work session kind of format, discussing the things that are new, particularly with respect to personnel or any other new initiative. The second work session is on January 14th, and that's John's section of the budget, we call it, because it has to do with maintenance and facilities and utilities and all of those topics. And those are there. You'll note that under that one, normally we would list capital, and probably we'll talk about capital there as well. But in between those two work sessions, we do have a regular school committee meeting on the 11th. It has a fairly light, typical agenda, but we do have a need to talk about capital kinds of projects, because if you go to the budget calendar on January 24th, the capital outlay. I don't have the date in front of me.
For the capital outlay, it should be January 20th.
It's Wednesday, January 20th.
Okay, January
20th. Okay. Yeah, okay, yeah.
All right. So, in order that the school committee have an opportunity to see what those recommendations for capital are, we would want to discuss them in this format. So Ray, I think when we get to the committee reports, we'll talk a bit more about that. But we will pay some attention on the January 11th regular school committee meeting, particularly to things that will be capital and I think also on the long-range HAWC project as well. So then the second work session comes along, and then the third work session, this is the section that deals mostly special education, but also vocational education as well. We have a work session with the school committee and the ADCOM, the Education Subcommittee of ADCOM. Likely there'll be other advisory committee members who may attend, but that will be a posted meeting, and it's on a Sunday morning at 8:30. That's a typical weekend meeting for us in January, and that will be to discuss the budget, because by then we will have presented all three of the sections of the budget and also the capital for them, so we can focus on their questions, concerns, and that kind of thing. And then the joint meeting is scheduled for the 28th, and that is the discussion of the budget with the Board of Selectmen and the full advisory committee. So just to give you a heads up, all of these meetings will be posted meetings, and so they'll have regular agendas, but we wanted you to know in advance what was going to be discussed when. So I think that is it for superintendent's report.
Good. One question. So on those nice certificates we received, where do they end up? At the schools or in the administration?
Well, there's one that is to the town. We'll keep here. The one that's to the town, although two are to the town and one for the high school. So I would send along the one that goes to the high school to the high school, and we'll put the others up here somewhere.
Well, since Brad is on the composting group, can we give it to him? To
absolutely
present?
Yeah, take it back. That would be great.
Brad, you want to come up here? Congratulations.
Thank you.
Take a lot of pride in that. Congratulations. All right, so does anybody have any questions for Dr. Gallo? Right.
So just seeing this email about the fencing at East, that's great news, terrific that we got the grant for that. I just noticed in the email that the PTO representative said they'd be contacting the building department at DigSafe today.
Yeah.
That shouldn't be the PTO doing that?
Well, Katie is involved in that.
Okay, because this office has to sign any building department application, and okay, as long as everyone knows that, because we've gone down that road before.
Right, I know, no, we know that, they know that we have to sign it, but
great.
They wanted us to know that
perfect.
They are going that route.
Any other questions for Dr. Gill? Any from the audience? Moving along to 5.1, communications. Communications received by the superintendent.
Yes, so there's a letter in your packet, a very positive letter from a grandparent who lives out of state but has grandchildren and also a daughter who works with us, complimenting two things really, complimenting our music and drama programs as programs, and here for all of you for giving support to the arts, even in very tough times, and secondly, to the students and the teachers for the quality of the program. So I have shared that letter with the folks who were mentioned in it. Secondly, this is just a reminder because this notice was in your last packet, but tomorrow night, and I guess this is a green night because tomorrow night there is a feature on NECN, and it involves the high school garden and Michael Page, who is the weather forecaster for NECN, came to Hingham a couple of weeks ago, did the taping, and that will be on tomorrow night in the second half hour of the regular evening news, but then also at the 10 o'clock news. And then as well, we're going to be able to access it online. So if you miss the early show or the late show, you can still see the clip online. So that's something that we just received today, that notice.
Brad?
All right, so first thing, the winter sports seasons have started up, and wrestling defeated Staunton, Weymouth, and Tollgate over the weekend, and will compete against Cohasset this Wednesday at 4 p.m. Girls basketball won their first home game against Plymouth North, and tomorrow night at 6:30 they will have Taco Tuesday. They will be also serving tacos at the concession stand. And also, in past news, the student-initiated group Inshore, with Christian Gervasi as the president and Mr. Dorr as the teacher advisor, helped with Christmas in the City with other student volunteers. And all of the musical concerts occurred in the past week, and everyone gave a great performance. And you can actually see pictures of the concerts on the Hingham High School website, which now has a slideshow where it used to have still pictures. And I believe that I've mentioned this in past Green News, but the sneaker drive went really well, and there was over 2,000 pairs of shoes donated, which will go to kids who need them, and some have even gone to the Red Cross. And in other Green News, the Green Team will be hosting a movie night on January 14th, and the movie will be the new documentary, Racing Extinction. And by next meeting on the 11th, I will be able to confirm if that is open to Hingham residents, but I believe it is. And as I know, this committee meeting is short, so is this school week in preparation for winter break. Thank you. Any questions or comments?
Nope. Enjoy
Thank
your
you.
Break. Do you have anything else, Dr. Gill, under communications?
Just to say that in your packet also is a little memo from Derek. There were a few questions last week about the upcoming field trip to Camp Wing, and he's provided that information there for your reading pleasure.
Anybody have any questions under communications? 6.1, to hear a report on the 2015 MA DESE Accountability Designation. Ellen.
I'm going over the Massachusetts Accountability Report that we do every year. These are the results from 2015. If you recall, usually when I do the MCAS report, we also do the accountability report because the information comes out at the same time. But this past year, given the fact that half of the school districts did park, that delayed the park reporting, which in turn delayed all of the accountability reporting as well. So just a little overview as far as this is concerned. This is a lot of changes happening. 2001, No Child Left Behind, was the federal legislation where the goal was to have all students proficient or advanced by 2014. The next thing that happened was 2012, the state of Massachusetts applied for and was granted a waiver from the No Child Left Behind provisions, along with many other states, because at the time they had not reauthorized the No Child Left Behind. And so this was a way that the Federal Department of Education gave to states to work on accountability systems that worked out better for them compared to the previous No Child Left Behind. The focus of the waiver in the current accountability system, the goal is to narrow the proficiency gaps between how all students and also subgroups of students are performing by the year 2017. So for every school in every district, there were targets based on where they started out at the beginning of this, targets for improvement for every year, and I'll go over the statistics basically that are used to make these determinations. And the latest news is this past December 10th, I think it is, the president signed into effect the Every Student Succeeds Act, or ESSA. So that's our new set of initials we have to learn. In terms of the major differences, it maintains the annual testing in grades 3 through 8 in ELA and math, as well as the three times that science has to be tested. And in our case, it's in 5th grade, 8th grade, and either 9th or 10th grade in high school. The major difference probably is that the accountability, many of the accountability decisions will be left up to the state instead of the federal oversight that we've had in the previous accountability systems. They're in the process, whenever you have these acts or laws that are enacted, they then go to the regulatory process where the Department of Education then interprets what that means. I think all of you have seen summaries of the new act and what it entails. I think it's very very likely that a lot of the concerns that people have had, both parents, teachers, school districts, about the extensive testing that was happening across the country, as well as the federal government spelling out the very specific accountability systems, and this gives more leeway to the states to deal with the accountability, as well as including things other than just academic results. So when you look at the accountability system, the statistics that you have to, oh, and the other thing too is next year, the waiver that we currently have is going to be officially ended, ours and other waivers, the end of this June 2016. Next year, 2016 to 2017, is a transition year, which we're not really sure what that entails. I expect that they will continue the same accountability system that we currently have. And then it's fully implemented in 2017-18, is the information that we've been given. So the current Massachusetts accountability system, the first statistic is a school percentile. And so what this information gives you is the overall performance of each of our schools and the district compared to other schools with the same grade span. So what that means is comparing every single elementary school that has the grade 5, K to 5 configuration, middle schools 6 through 8, and high schools 9 through 10. The levels are 1 through 5. Level 1 is the highest performing. Number 5 is the lowest, and it's reported for all students, which is referred to as the aggregate, and for high-need students, which is a combination of kids on IEPs. What used to be called low income is now called economically disadvantaged, and ELL students is put together into one group called high needs. The reports also report out on those other subgroups, but it's the high needs and the overall that makes the decision as far as what the accountability level is. You have to, in order to also be in level one, you have to have a minimum of 95% participation in ELA math and science, and that's true not just overall but also the subgroups. So if you can look at the next one, Dart. Okay, so the PPI and then the CPPI. The PPI basically is a measure of improvement from one year to the next. It's a formula that includes, as you can see down at the bottom, those CPPI indicators, narrowing the proficiency gap that I mentioned before in EL math and science, the student growth percentiles, which you've seen in the MCAS test, but this is for the schools in ELA and math. You're given, the school is given a 25-point extra credit, if you will, if they make a 10% increase in scoring in advanced in ELA math and science, and also gives you 25 points if you decrease the failing and the warning score as well. The thing that you have, it's attached to my report, is the overall summary of the accountabilities for both the district and the schools. There's a very detailed version of it up at the right hand side if you go on the profiles that are on the Mass DOE, which has maybe 5 or 6 pages with all the details of how they came up with those designations. So 75 is the target, using all of those things. So you can see, and we're very pleased, as Dot said last time, she couldn't share what the results were, but that you'd be very happy. So you can see the outstanding results that we have. And so you can see our 4 elementary schools, 3 out of the 4, East Foster and South, students, our school scored in the 94th percentile, which is amazing. And Plymouth River, the 98th percentile, which actually I think this is the second year that they scored in the 98th percentile. The middle school in the 85th percentile and the high school in the 91st percentile. Okay, so this is the breakdown of the CPPI target. That's a 75, and the results are for all students and then the high needs subgroup. So you can see on the left-hand side for all students, East, Foster, and PRS were 100%, 97% at South, 88 at the middle school, 99 at the high school, and 90 for the entire school district. So you can see clearly that at all schools in the district level we met, obviously scored higher than the 75 target. And when you look at the high needs students, the breakdown, that disaggregated result, you can see that East, Foster, PRS, and the high school met or exceeded the target, which is why they're level one schools, and the middle school and South did not meet it in the high needs, and so that's why they have a level two designation. The district is given, automatically given the designation of its lowest performing school. So that's why the district is at level two. Next. Okay, so our results, as we just looked at, all were in the highest performing using the school percentiles. In using all or the aggregate, all of the students far exceeded the targets at all 6 schools. At the high needs, East Foster, PRS, and the high school did. Plymouth River, for the second year, as Dot mentioned earlier, letter from Garrett Bradley, is a commended school. And this year, it's for both high achievement and high progress or growth. So that's quite a recognition 2 years in a row for Plymouth River, for students and staff, and Chuck and Melissa. The high needs CPI was below the target in South and the middle school. the next one. So what happens is any of the schools that are designated level two, there's a very thick guideline in terms of the details of the actions that they have to go through. Essentially what it is analyzing in detail the high needs information, which I mentioned before. There is a document called Conditions for School Effectiveness, which is very similar to the district effectiveness standards and indicators, if you remember when we did the strategic planning meeting, when we had the Council of Councils. We used the district version of the school effectiveness. They have to revise their school improvement plans with interventions and support. All of our schools, but in particular level two schools, have to send out report cards, which will be coming out probably in another month or two. And then if it's a Title I school, the Title I funding is supposed to be prioritized for them. So that's the overview. And if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Do we have any questions? Liza.
Hi.
So for the level two schools,
yep.
When the DESE has all these requirements, does someone come from the DESE, or how burdensome is all that extra information to data crunch?
Part of my job, as being the person who coordinates all the DOE mandates, is to work with the principals of the schools. I usually meet with them. We go over the results. Because both South and the middle school have been level two schools before, this is not a new process for them. And so what they will do is they'll go over the information from this past year and then tweak the school improvement plan. The school improvement plan that you see that's approved is an overall school improvement plan. This is a more detailed, it's about 5 or 6 pages, very specific about what the strengths and areas that need to be improved, very specific intervention strategies that are built in, and we have those for both areas here, the South School and the Middle School. So they'll be in the process of, and they already have started analyzing the results in detail, looking at the interventions and the strategies that they put into place to see did they work or not work, and then update that. And so it's my responsibility to make sure that they do that, which they do a great job and take it very seriously. And I do want to say both South and the middle school, although they didn't make their targets for the high needs, they improved.
Okay.
And in particular at the South School, improved, and you could, if you remember from when I did the MCAS test, their results were quite high. The problem is with this accountability, it goes over 4 years. Mm. So even though this past year South really improved all of their scores, the scores from the previous 3 years are integrated into that target number. And in the middle school, what I was pleased to see is a lot of the high needs results, particularly in math, improved. So that's why it's good to look at the more detailed version of it, because you can see, when you just look at the overall, it gives you a sense, but you can actually look and see, were there more improvements in math or ELA in certain groups? And so that information is very valuable for them as they work on their new or updated school improvement plan.
Okay.
Any other questions? Carol.
Ellen, question on, so the high needs students, I am going to assume they vary from school to school. Does that impact the test results here?
It does somewhat, and the reason for that is because you have to have a subgroup of at least 25 students for the results to be included. And there is a variation at the elementary level where we have more or less than that 25. And part of, when I was looking at the detail, part of what happened in not all the schools, but one of the schools that had a higher number, they got extra credit because they did that advanced designation where you can get points for that, mm-hmm. and also reducing the warning. And so that counted when you had the high need subgroup and the special ed subgroup. But when you look at, and I think Self is in that situation, where they had less than 25, so the report was not there. So in a way, it's not held against you because it's not there, but it also doesn't give you the opportunity to get the extra credit because the numbers are too low to be reported.
And are the strategies that are implemented across the board at the various schools the same, or are they different? Because, you know, it's a bit of a variance here on on the score. So I'm curious, is there some...
I'd say, I mean, we pride ourselves on our curriculum instruction and assessment being district-wide. Mm-hmm. And so if you remember from my MCAS report, we always look at the variance of the range between the four elementary schools. And if I remember correctly, there was very little range in most of the areas, but a large range in the ELA, particularly in the fourth grade, between the schools. Mm-hmm. And so even though South School and the middle school are the ones at a level two, that doesn't mean that the other schools don't do the same analysis and use the interventions. So for instance, if you look at South's results versus one of the other schools, their results actually are higher. But when you put it into this formula and the calculations based on how things are weighted, they're level two and the other school is level one. So yes, our interventions, we have a very vibrant RTI program, K through five now, and a first and second grade math, TMI, targeted math instruction, which is very well regarded and I think really has had a lot to do with the increase in our scores and our academic results. And we frequently have schools from other districts come in and observe and look at our model. And so it's not that different. Mary, do you want to say anything?
I think you can do it. And we all meet together all the time. And
you have to come up.
Mary, also just state your name.
Sorry about that.
Mary Eastwood, principal of South Elementary. And basically what Ellen said is correct, and we all meet together all the time, and a lot of the strategies that most of the strategies that are being used, we all use them. So we just, you know, actually do a complete analysis of everything. And some of the things we're coming out with is that a lot of the things that last year were a problem were a weakness and now a strength. So what Ellen said is true, that things have gone up a great deal, but I think we just kind of caught in the statistic.
Yeah, just like PRS, I think 2 years ago had missed it by 1 point. Mm-hmm. You know, so I think overall South's results are excellent.
They were amazing.
And Mary and her staff have worked really hard, you know, to improve those things. But when you put all these numbers together with different weightings, you know, sometimes it doesn't come out exactly the way you want it to come out.
Yeah, we were a little disappointed, but we know we weren't disappointed with the overall results. Those were excellent. So we were very pleased with the number of students in proficient and advanced, and also with the decrease in students in warning and needs improvement. Those graphs went way down, and proficient and advanced went way up. So,
and like Mary said, we meet once a month before our administrative council. I meet with the four principals. We work on curriculum things. The directors, the various directors come in and we work on projects together. We share, and you know, frequently when we have the school improvement plans and the presentations, people have asked questions about, do you do that at the other school? Yes, we do that at the other school.
We all talk all the time. And the specialists, we share them, like the math specialist, and you know, it's the same math specialist that's at East, that's at South, and also the reading specialists are always getting together and comparing notes, not to mention other departments. Everybody shares everything. All for one and one for all, right?
Right.
I got another question.
So just real quickly. So it says we're a level two school. Really, we're a 1.33 if you average it out.
But, I guess so.
How many level So how many school districts does this take into consideration? How many level one schools are out there?
I just happen to have that information here. Yep, so for schools, level one, 29% of schools in Massachusetts are level one, 51% level two, 18% level three, and 2% level four. And for districts, it's 19% are level one, 62% are level two, 16% level three, and 2% level four. Essentially, levels three and four, using those percentiles that you saw at the beginning, they take the bottom 20% of the school's results and district results, and they're put into level three and four. Level four obviously having much lower results, as well as frequently having been in level three for a while and continuing not to meet targets. And then, go ahead, and then there are, I think, some, are they called Commonwealth districts? I think there are four or five where the Department of Education has, in a few instances, taken over the school district, and two or three maybe on the verge of that happening.
And remember that schools are all sorts of different sizes, and many, many elementary schools in particular are small schools, 200 to 300 students in total, and therefore that high needs group, and those schools can be very small and not become a component of that.
And frequently you'll see middle schools in level two, probably more so than elementary schools and high schools. And part of that is the middle school, particularly our 6, 7, and 8, are the only, it's the only school that all grades and all kids in the whole school are tested. Where at the elementary schools, it's just 3, 4, and 5, and at the high schools, it's just 9 and 10.
Did you have a question?
I had a question on the ESSA. Has the DESE, or sorry of all these acronyms, so on the new federal standards, or not even standards, but the new federal act, has the State Department of Elementary and Secondary Education indicated anything about what their plans are to react to this, or any timing? Or
not at all, and it would be premature for them to do so because they haven't done the regulations that go along with it.
Okay.
I don't know if Dot would agree with me, but because they had the waiver for our current accountability system, that would lead me to believe that they probably will continue that next year during a transitional year, and then whatever it is they're going to change would do by the next year.
We have a lot of transitions.
A lot
many
of
years of transitions coming up.
So right now you'll see, just like on your listservs and mine and on all the various Ed Week and so on, there are lots of summaries about what it entails and how they're different. But the regulations haven't come out yet. And so once that happens and the waiver runs out at the end of June, then the Massachusetts Department of Education would have to be working on that. But I think they probably will keep the same.
There is a document in your packet that assessment decision facts. And it's just a summary of the next steps in terms of this spring for the MCAS. And I did enter your vote and our decision to go to stay with MCAS for the coming year last week. But it's a good document because it indicates what they're going to do most immediately.
I do think that since we brought it up, though, that we'll see in the assessment update is there are going to be changes to this spring's 2016 MCAS, even though we're not going to park. And they are going to have what they call park-like items, although the most recent communication came out is that they'll have, for the park-like items and the ELA and the math, the scoring will be separate from the MCAS scoring. And what we've done for years and years, where we've had that long composition in fourth and seventh grade as a separate test, that's been eliminated. And the reason that they said it was eliminated is because they're going to have a, what they call a response to text question, a park-like question that will be at every grade instead of just having a long composition at fourth grade and seventh grade. So even though we have made, you all and we all made the decision about staying with MCAS, there are changes and we're in the process of updating our staff about that. And essentially what we've said is continue the great teaching that you've been doing all along, and once the final MCAS 2.0 comes into play, then I expect we'll continue to do well, and anything that we don't do well in, we'll do what we usually do, which is work hard to do better.
So Ellen, going back to the level two stuff, so on your slide five there, you go what the DSE requirements for level two schools.
Yep.
So how much of a burden does this put on you guys? I mean, does it increase a lot?
I'd say it probably put on a great burden the first couple of times we had to do it. Mary, I don't know if you'd agree, because it was a new process, the steps going, taking the conditions for school effectiveness. You had to go through a whole self-assessment process. So I had done that before, and so when we first met with you, and if you remember, PRS has been level two, and East has been level two as well, sat down with the principals, went over it, and then took, no exaggeration, things like this, talk about time, about the process you have to do, and put it together in a one-page summary of do this, do this, do this, do this. And so I think the first couple of times we did it,
I was actually, I wasn't principal yet, but I was involved, and it was a very long process. But it's at least now you have a recipe that you're going to tweak.
Right,
that's probably the best way to describe it. Where we were inventing it before,
yeah, they were completely developing it and hadn't done it before. Where now they have an existing school improvement plan from last year that they're going to compare to the results and look at what worked and what didn't and update it. So I'd say now probably as not as much time, but I'm not going to minimize it. It is
well, it just seems to me like
a lot of time on.
You, we know how many kids, you look at our overall scores, which is on page, I don't know, just where you had it there, 94, 94, 94, 98. Those are so high. We have so many kids who are already operating at above proficient or advanced. So there's only so many kids that we have. So it's, as you mentioned, it's a statistical challenge.
It and is. Sometimes a matter of two or three kids makes a difference.
And then the fact that four of the six schools are level one, I just don't like it when we have to do extra work when the thing's running well.
I think one of the things that we try very hard to do is not just to comply, but to make it meaningful. And so when we do these things, when we first started and so on, I work hard with the principals and they work hard with their staff to make sure that the interventions and things they're doing are best practice things that we want to do anyways.
Exactly.
Right.
It's all the things that we, it's good teaching and
right.
best practices. That's exactly it. And we've been going over it with a fine tooth comb. We go over it all the time anyway. And we've been going over it with a fine tooth comb. And we changed some things last year and we'll change some more things. And
but I feel strongly that we really should focus on those percentiles.
I agree.
Rather than an artificial target of 75, right. which is based on up to seven indicators to come up with a number. You know, what does that mean if you get a 65 versus a 75? And to me, the impressive thing is the percentile. So as I said to Mary and her staff, I think they're doing a great job. Same thing with Derek and his staff. And there were improvements if you look into the details across the board, and particularly at the middle school with the high needs kids in math. So just looking at those numbers, I don't think gives you the entire picture. So I think we need to celebrate what our staff is doing.
Wonderful. Thank you very much.
Absolutely. Yep. Thank you.
We'll move on to 6.2,
This is a field trip. It's an annual field trip, Model UN. However, there's a new teacher who will be organizing the trip this year, new AP teacher, and I will say that we know the form is supposed to be typed. I didn't notice it wasn't until today. However, this is wonderful handwriting, so it's very legible. So I'm not going to ask her to write it, do it over again.
Wonderful. Okay, so 7, other items as may not reasonably be known 48 hours in advance of the meeting. Dr. Galli, you mentioned you wanted to talk about something there.
Yes, actually two things that ironically not planned are related, but one of them is in your packet, and that is the PowerPoint slide from our first planning meeting for enhancing our security system. And this has been facilitated, of course, by a grant, a state grant that Garrett Bradley was helpful in getting for us, and I think for his other districts as well. And so this is a grant that involves our hiring of a consultant with much experience in the area. And essentially there'll be three things that will result from this grant. The consultant will do an assessment of the current security measures that we have in the district. He'll be visiting all the schools. He'll be meeting with groups of people, including our maintenance people, the principals, the head custodians, Board of Health, fire and police. Both the chiefs were at our meeting today. So that's one thing, to assess what we have. The second is to move us forward to another level, and particularly we're hoping with respect to the technology that we actually have in the district, so much of the technology we have that will allow us to enhance our communications, especially communications within the building and communications between the building and the emergency responders, kind of thing. And the third thing is that he'll be putting together a report that we can all share, and we don't talk about the details of exactly what we're doing, but I think that you will be able to share in the report. And if we wanted to discuss that report, we certainly could do that in an executive session that will come later this spring. So we're very excited about that, and we just happen to have scheduled for today the first meeting. First meeting involved John and Ellen and me, the fire chief, the police chief, Katie Hartman, Paul Field. Doug was not there today, but he would be part of the effort, and two principals, Tony, Katie, and Paula, who volunteered to be part of the committee. So many other people will be consulted as part of this, but they are part of what we call a steering committee that kind of sets direction as to what we will do, where and when. And so our consultant's name is Don Schmidt, very well known in this area. In fact, he's come to Hingham a couple of times when there have been what they call these tabletop exercises that are done on the town side but involve us, simulated kinds of emergencies and hazards that the town tries to plan around. So we're very excited about that. Ironically, on Friday, also not planned, we had an incident at Plymouth River School, which fortunately turned out to be something that we didn't have to be concerned about, but we live in scary times. People are very uptight, and that means adults, all of us who work in schools, certainly, parents clearly very concerned about security, and even youngsters, even some of our youngsters, youngest youngsters. You know, they hear parents and adults talking, they hear what the media is saying, so it's a scary time for everyone, and we can't ever afford to be complacent, and whenever anything out of line is reported, we are going to respond. The irony here was that this particular incident, which involved a very young child who thought she saw an individual in the area of the school, didn't report it right away. So the sighting appeared, the sighting occurred at 1 to 1:15 at the end of a lunch period, looking out a cafeteria window. She didn't tell anybody about that until later. And in fact, Melissa Smith, the assistant principal, was only informed at 2:15 in the afternoon, and dismissal in that building is at 2:30. So immediately, our priorities are contact emergency personnel, stabilize the site, do everything we can do to make students and adults safe, And then when we've done all of those things, we certainly do notify parents. But the first priorities have to be emergency personnel on site, stabilizing and clearing the scene, and then deciding what the next step steps will be. And here, as part of the next step, which also took a little longer, was that we did decide, five cruisers showed up, the school resource officer was there, the incident had occurred more than an hour before, there was seemed to be no immediate danger, and as well, we had police on site, we decided to go forward with normal dismissal. And if you've ever been at one of the schools during dismissal, that's a masterful enterprise that we recreate 180 times during the year, of getting 500 to 600 plus students out of our elementary buildings in a timely fashion. So we did send an email to parents. I know that parents are anxious, and I know that they're nervous, but I think they would agree that the first priority has to be making sure everyone is safe. So so I wanted to mention that publicly. We had very, very little in terms of parents who communicated with me. I got two communications. I don't know exactly how many calls there were at Plymouth River. I don't think very many. Chuck didn't happen to be here on Friday, so Ellen went over there so there'd be two administrators who are managing the system. So I think we have a process that works very well, but unfortunately, as these things happen, sometimes it gets to social media, and therein lies a big problem that I hope we can work together to do a better job at. And I do understand that when people don't get immediate information, they reach out to places like social media. We wish they would call us. We wish they would be a little more patient, but that has been a new problem. What didn't happen this time that sometimes happens is that often if there's a 911 call, we have members of the press who monitor 911 calls, and often I will get, or you will get, or a call even before the personnel are on site, wanting to know what's going on, and the press reporting those things. That didn't happen in this time because the first person called was John Walden, who is the elementary resource officer. He contacted the police to get the cruisers there without there being a press leak through the radio. So we'll continue to establish those priorities, and I just want people to know them. We get the information out to parents as soon as we possibly can. A part of it is we want to have something to tell parents that's meaningful. I think we are simply to notify parents there's a problem at Plymouth River, we don't know the extent of it yet. You can imagine that could cause even more panic and distress, and even people jumping into cars and trying to get to the site and all those things. So it took us a little longer to get the word out this time because we wanted to do this dismissal and get those kids home as near to schedule as we can. So we have a debriefing meeting always at the site, and which happened on Friday afternoon. We talked about it this morning. We talked about it in this meeting that we had with the steering committee. So got a lot of good news. One is that there wasn't a credible emergency on Friday in the end, and that's great. And I want to be sure that parents and even children understand that, you know, this notion of see something, do something is really important. So while this didn't turn out to be an accurate perception, we wouldn't want to discourage anybody, an adult or a child, from reporting something if they see they're concerned about, and reporting it promptly, I guess, is the other message, because this was nearly an hour later. But some of those messages can be reinforced. And then once everybody else is notified, I try to make sure that you're all notified as well, and that the other principals were. With respect to the other principals getting the message, by the time that notification went out, it was Friday, it was past dismissal time there. And so we did have one glitch, and the one glitch was that we didn't notify Kids in Action. And of course, some of the Plymouth River children ended up at Kids in Action, and were talking about this incident, and Kathy didn't know about it. Well, Kids in Action sites, there are two Kids in Action sites, and Those principals got the message, but they got the message after dismissal time, and so there was no consequence of that. But you know, we add another note to the packet and the folder of things that we do. So anyway, we're very excited about the new grant, and very appreciative. As you know, we're recipients of a grant similarly facilitated by Garrett and Jamie, I would guess, as well, 3 or 4 years ago, and that allowed us to buy cameras and things. And this one is going to be more focused on assessing what we have and enhancing, particularly around communications and assessment and technology.
Anybody have any questions for Dr. Hill?
Right. So, comment, two quick questions. I'm the only parent with Plymouth River kids, so mm-hmm. I found out about it. My girls got off the bus at 2:45, told my wife, she called me, and then I called Dot. And while we were talking, and I appreciate you taking the time, and I let you go quickly because I knew you were busy, mm-hmm. the email came through from Melissa Smith. So I thought it was handled really terrifically. Mm-hmm. I thought it was timely. You shared information as was necessary, what you knew, but it was still an ongoing situation, so you could only say so much, mm-hmm. and I think what was said at the time was appropriate. So I thought it was handled very, very well.
Thank you.
Just on the security consultant, so this is the more recent state grant.
Yes, $90,000.
That's the $90,000 mm-hmm. grant, right.
And much of that will go to pay the consultant, but then there is an amount in there for some equipment and also for some training.
Right. So I was going to ask the cost of the consultant. Mm-hmm.
The base is 45.
Okay. 45. We do have a contract with him.
Okay. Any other questions? Yes, Dr. Schreier.
On the grants, have all the monies been spoken for, or are there any monies left over?
Well, there are categories of dollars where we don't have the specific things, for example, in the equipment we're going to buy. So the contract is certainly covers his salary. That is spoken for. The other two categories are categories that have some flexibility about them. So we have some things that we think we need to buy, or he may point out some connections that we need to make to be sure that our technology can do everything that we are thinking it can do.
John? Yeah, so they'd be, so I mean, the money would be allocated between contractors and you could call them consultants or contractors, equipment and training. So I mean, during the course of this study and the evaluation, it determines we need some additional equipment to sort of make the communication systems that we have do a certain thing, we have monies to buy that equipment. If it turns out that we need a different contractor to do some programming for us of a specific system a certain way, we'd hire another programmer to get that. So you know, it's not all allocated right now, but we have it allocated in buckets, and to the extent that we don't need to spend it in accordance with exactly the way we thought it might lay out, we can always do an amendment to up certain categories or reduce other categories. So the only contractual obligation we have right now is just that contract to do this thorough analysis, actually do it, it's a lot of its implementation too. It's implementation of systems we have in place, so really at the end result we're performing security measures across the district.
Refresh my memory. Is there one? Are we talking about one grant or two?
Well, we had one a couple of years ago. Right. That was for $288,000, and we were able to use those funds for, you know, various security initiatives, including cameras and other stuff.
It was a federal grant.
It was an amendment to the budget. This was an amendment to the state budget, not federal.
It was
federal.
A state grant.
But the 288 came through the Homeland Security.
No. It was
a state grant.
It was a state grant.
Amendment to the
as this one
budget.
Is.
There was some talk. Garrett, I think, had tried to thought that there might be some Homeland Security money coming into the state,
That's what I thought it was. I thought it was a two-step, that it was federal money that came into the state, and therefore they amended the budget.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I thought it was, but could be wrong.
Yeah, it wasn't managed under the auspices of a federal grant. It was really managed through the DESE, and they used their grant process to manage the money, for lack of any other way of managing this type of funds.
The good thing is that because it was a grant and designated specifically for school use for security, the money came directly to us, so we didn't have to go through the town process of having it allocated, which can slow things up.
Have those funds all been expended?
Oh, yes, yeah. That was spent a couple of years. Well, we probably finished, yeah. When did we get that? Was it last budget?
It was the 16 budget. It was 3 years ago. We didn't really get the money. We knew that we were going to be getting it in January of the year, but we really didn't get it formally confirmed
until October of that year.
So we got a late start on that.
So we did that project. Typically the grant will run for a year. So you want to spend those funds during the course of that year. Have it encumbered such that you have ongoing initiatives that you'll complete, you know, as a result of using that money.
Any other questions?
Personally, since this is going to continue where we're going to need more money for this stuff, unfortunately, I know we got a lot of good money and Ray can speak more to it with the middle school, but I almost feel the MSBA should come up with a third. You know, we have the new school, we have the windows, boilers, roofs. They should also have a security initiative program, because what's going on out there, everyone needs this stuff. Okay. And we can't always be relying on these grants. We need some sort of program. So,
any other questions? Good. All right, so eight, subcommittee and project reports. We got a lot of good things going on. We'll start with Cynthia down there.
Survey results and are making some small changes to the current website based on that feedback. So thank you again, everyone. And we'll continue to look at that. Our next meeting is tomorrow at 8 o'clock.
Dr. Schreier.
Can I just ask a question
sure.
about that?
So
I thought we were going to discuss the results before implementation of changes.
It's not, well, it's we can. I am putting together a summary of the results. It's not as much based specifically on those. It's more stuff that Joe's doing along the way. So there's two tracks that are happening at the same time. Joe's been making changes to the website based on feedback he's been getting from a lot of different areas, and then we're also looking at the website to make sort of bigger changes along the way.
Okay, but that's not going to happen in a vacuum, right? We're going to talk about it.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, the last meeting, you had all these comments, and so it was a lot of just reading the comments there and, you know, digesting.
No surprises, really. They're the same. They're categories of things. You know, one category is that people want, at the elementary level, they want the menu front and center. Everybody wanted the day number. Readily available.
X2 is very popular.
Mm-hmm.
X2?
Yeah, well, it was reference to X2, even though it was about the website. parents want to be able to navigate the site more easily. And given that the goal was to look at what we could do with the current website to enhance it, it wasn't as if we were starting all over again. There were some things like search capabilities and so on that are really limited with respect to our website just by the very nature of the how it's set up. So there are some things that just kind of are out there. I didn't see anything in any of those that we haven't heard before from someone.
Well, and also, right, what we've just had a chance to look at is the eSchool site now is a little formatted differently based on these comments. So it'd be great if you took a look at that. And that even, tomorrow, I have some even comments of making that even a little cleaner. But it's just a matter of shifting information around on the site. It's not creating new menus or new pieces. So the initiative is more of, you know, can we raise the lunch menu link higher on the page so that it's easier access? we haven't written any or even talked about writing any new content. It's just a matter of placement of things on the site to make it easier based on the comments from the survey. So I'd love for everybody to take a look at the east page. And it really doesn't look, it doesn't look a whole lot different. It's just a little cleaner to consolidate some information. So, but we're just going to, I mean, I think tomorrow one of the things we're going to do is talk about what Joe did on the eSchool site to see how does that look based on what we had talked about, the items from the survey that we thought were the most important.
Right, and the bigger school committee conversation will be about changing, you know, categories on the website, or, you know, whether this kind of thing should be under this, you know, menu, and I'll certainly put together something we can all look at in advance, because that's a fairly detailed conversation, so.
And we're going to do a training. One of the things that we really never did was a real thorough training for our staff. And so, you know, a limited number of people can change certain things, and a few people can change certain things. And so we have a sched training for principals, their tech person, their administrative assistant in most cases, on the 12th of January.
Was it the 7th? Was it the 12th?
I think it's the 12th.
Okay.
With Joe, right. And so the people will be more able to make changes and keep things up to date and that kind of thing.
Good. Dr. Shore.
The Special Education Subcommittee met last week on the 17th, and the principal topic that we dealt with was the idea of transferring some of the monies that were turned back at the end of our fiscal year, the $226,446 dollars, and the idea, suggestion, thoughts on transferring this to the Special Ed Stabilization Fund. And we voted, and I'll suggest to you all tonight that we have voted to recommend to transfer $100 of those $1,000 essentially from fund balance to the stabilization account. And we'll have a formal motion with the proper wording at our meeting on the 11th.
Now, would that be, we're just voting on that? Does that then require a warrant article, or?
We won't vote on that tonight.
Right.
Mentioning people to think about this tonight.
But then if we pursue that path.
We would vote on it.
We will vote on it on the 11th. And if, in fact, it passes with a majority,
correct,
then it'll be done through a warrant article, which has to be in place by the 20th of January.
Correct.
That's correct.
So you might want to then, we can use some of the time, as Dr. Gallo mentioned, of our budget meetings. So we're either going to have to see the warrant either, the, you know, before or whatever you're drafting.
So we don't have to have language by the 20th. We just
have the placeholder
mark. Article.
Right.
Okay.
So we have to vote the concept if we want to actually ask for a warrant article to be submitted. And we just need, the language would need to be refined, but it doesn't have to be, I don't think, precise.
But we still have to make sure that everyone's aware of the process. And the process is,
right,
if we vote for this, the next step would be then a warrant article.
Correct.
Correct.
Okay.
Question.
Sure.
How did you come up with $100,000 as the recommendation versus more, or where'd that number come from?
It was an interesting suggestion that was made by one of the members, and I'd like to take credit for it, but I can't because that was not my suggestion. But I it struck me as a very reasonable number. There's $250,000 in that account right now. The threshold is something in the neighborhood, 2% is something in the neighborhood of 700,000 and change. The crisis was precipitated by a $533,000 surprise 3 years ago. So it seems as if building it on an incremental basis, you know, really makes sense. It seems as if $100,000, you know, would make sense.
And I think Dot had suggested that $100,000 could be a likely tuition. So that would be a number to kind of, that we talked about zeroing in. And also, it felt like a reasonable number and not felt like we were trying to be greedy and saying all of that money. Mm-hmm. Just trying to work with everybody and but also help this fund with having additional funds.
Mm-hmm. And keep the momentum going.
Yep.
Yeah.
We put money in last year, and so putting a more modest amount in this year. And just FYI, we, that 533 that Ed mentioned, which was now 3 or 4 years ago, that came because we had a couple of move-ins when we were already in the budget process. We've had two move-ins already this fall. Now, the dollars there are not as significant as 533, and they are in advance of our, you know, being able to put them in the budget. But it just does go to show that you can have several years with not that occurrence, and then all of a sudden, in the space of a month, we had two students move in who were in out-of-district placements this year. So always good to keep working at the problem.
And just to remind folks, so out of, you'll remember, out of the $1.6 million that was taken from fund balance to cover the town's snow expenses, 247 came to the school department, but then we returned 226 and change at the end of the year. So we're still in the red a little bit when you compare the two numbers, but the town also put a lot more into fund balance at the end of the fiscal year than I think they anticipated doing. So given that circumstance, we felt it was reasonable to make the request, but the lower number, you know, representative of an average tuition.
And we'll also be getting some FEMA money.
Yeah.
That's coming our way.
Gotcha. All right, so everyone's understood that the special ed subcommittee has voted in their committee to recommend a $100,000 transfer. We're going to vote that at the next meeting. So if you have any other questions, see Dr. Schreier, or ask now, or, you know, ask before we vote on it. Carol?
I have nothing to report for salary negotiations, but we will be having a meeting in early January.
Great. Ray, since there's a lot going on with you, I'd rather go to okay. Policy. Yes?
Could I just mention, Linda was here, but she was going to mention to ADCOM this evening that this was going to be announced as a proposal, but not a vote tonight. She's going to go back and let them know that you've entertaining that motion, and we'll vote next time. So trying to keep everybody in the loop.
Great.
Okay.
Thank you. Instead of moving on, because he's got some stuff on long-range plan, let's go to policy first.
Policy, we are meeting January 5th to continue. We haven't done anything since the last meeting, but to continue sections five and six to the initial review of that, and talk about a couple of fees and the vendor policy. And so one thing, if any of you, we would love your input of the sections five and six, it's regarding students. We are looking at all of the handbooks from all the schools to make sure that all of the policies are covered in the handbooks and vice versa, just for consistency. So if any of you see anything or know of anything, please let us know, because they're pretty thick, and to catch all those details and consistencies, many eyes would be beneficial.
Good. Right, long-range planning.
Okay. So first on the PRS window SOI, we're still waiting for the MSBA to come out with its information and instructions on application for the new round of the accelerated repair program. So that should come out sometime in January with a likely deadline of second week of February. That's what it's been historically. So, you know, we'll obviously need to talk more about that, make a formal decision again to move forward, even though we kind of have, and then we'll need the selectmen to vote on that as well in order to proceed before the application can be submitted. Let's see.
While you're still on that one.
Yeah.
So we talk about placeholders for warrants.
Yeah.
The program doesn't come out to second week of February. Are we going to put a placeholder for a warrant article?
I anticipate. Well, we talked about this in long range, and we actually, it's unclear when it would fall, because based on the information we're getting, it's taking almost a year from initial application to even hear back from the MSBA that yes, you're accepted and we'll work with you, and then they move forward into the feasibility stage. We learned that a couple of months ago, that it was taking, you know, nearly a year, I think.
Yeah, from February through November.
Right.
Doing okay. Last year's applicants.
So that being the case, well, I guess that would be fiscal 17 still. So the question is how quickly we would need that, the funding for at least the initial stage of it. So we may need a placeholder warrant article for at least a portion, but we won't know what that will be.
That's fine. I'm just making sure everyone's aware of the logistics.
Until the application comes out. It'll be in advance of the January 20th, for sure, because they have to give us at least a little time.
Didn't have a lot of time in the past.
No, there's not. There's usually like 3 weeks. Right. It's not a lot of time. But there should be a way to determine what the feasibility stage funding should be.
Really on the MSBA right. website, and you grab some comps. That's what I did last time. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we just update those and see if we find projects of similar size, and you can assess what the cost of the OPM and the feasibility study would be. So, MSBA can help too. I mean, they have contacts that you can call, and they won't tell you directly, but they will tell you if you go here on the website, you'll see some other projects that were like that.
And just also, you always say, people watching at home, recap how this has been a part of the
sure.
long time. So it's not, because I know some people get here little bits and pieces and stuff.
Yeah.
But this has been a part of our master plan and, you know, stuff.
Right. So the 10-year master plan that was initially put together, I think the report was January of 2006. It was undertaken by the school building committee that was formed by town meeting in 2006. East Elementary came out of that, the new middle school came out of that, repairs and renovations to Foster and Plymouth River came out of that, and essentially completing the goals of the 10-year master plan right about on schedule, interestingly. What was not done, and there was actually a bid obtained, for the window work was the windows, because as part of the $7 million that town, I think a special town meeting in 2008, appropriated $3.5 million for Foster, $3.5 million for Plymouth River. A lot of that was eaten up by code upgrades that were not anticipated. So as a result, the full replacement of the windows at PRS couldn't be done. And I think at the time that bid was something like $800,000.
Yeah, the PRS. Between $800,000 and $900,000, and the Foster's was, I think, around $7 million.
Right.
So
what did get done as part of that project was replacement of door and window assemblies at both schools.
Right.
Most notably at the entrance and the cafeteria window assembly wall, for a lesser amount of money that fit into the budget. So that window job never really got done at either school. And discussing in long range and among the seven of us over the last year or two, kind of a decision was made that the Plymouth River was a school that more investment should be made in specifically to get the window project done. And it's been on the capital list year after year after year. We've talked about it, we've kind of kicked the can down the road, and made a decision, that we'd move forward with this year. That's the reason why we're going to pursue a statement of interest with the MSBA for an accelerated repair program where they do reimburse. I think the baseline reimbursement rate is around 30%. It may be a little bit higher than that, but I don't anticipate it'll be much higher than that.
And it's a program where you can get windows, roofs, and boilers. And again, the information and the application comes out in January with a deadline of second week of February, typically. So that's that on PRS. The high school Hawk project. So for those at home, Hawk, Aileen, you can take credit for this every time we say it, Health and Wellness Center. It's a great acronym. So where we are in that is moving a little slowly, but I do kind of where we are is still trying to define the scope of the project, hopefully with the help of an architect, and we've been in touch with Al Carney, a local architect who has been involved in kind of the concept of the project over the years. And actually I'm going to meet with him tomorrow to kind of talk about, you know, better defining and refining the scope to get kind of conceptual design, if you will, so that we can take that and come up with a number that the actual design for a project will cost that will need to be in a warrant article for town meeting. You know, I think in long range we talked about you know, how large the scope could be and how small it could be, and maybe simplifying it by you know, talking about a new structure that could house, you know, maybe fitness and a new classroom, and then renovating select portions of the interior without doing kind of a wholesale renovation that would involve a lot of mechanical work that could be a lot more involved and costly. Maybe that's a way to go. We just kind of started to broach on that. Just because it's hard to kind of narrow down the scope without a designer working with us. Specifically, it's really hard to kind of narrow down, right, how can we take all of the space, because we know what the needs are that have been expressed in terms of classroom space for the health curriculum, which we learned, you know, recently there's a proposal to change and increase the health curriculum. Additional space for physical education, locker room improvements, meeting space, facilities for coaches and visiting referees, and then, you know, a fitness space and a fitness center for our students and our athletes that isn't essentially a converted storage room that ends up being a pass-through from the outdoors into the rest of the facilities. You know, there's been talk about, you know, using the wrestling space, which is used for a lot of purposes right now, including demonstrations for the health curriculum, for physical education, for sports teams during the winter months for batting practice, for the wrestling team, multi-purpose, maybe renovating that space so it could be a true multi-purpose space. So maybe that's a space that we earmark as a space to renovate. You know, maybe the existing weight room gets repurposed as storage and a true pass-through, because there's a door from the outside to go in. But then how do you incorporate a new structure if we're gonna build a new structure adjacent to that? So we talked a lot about it, but again, it's kind of hard to delve into the details of it because there's a whole host of mechanical systems involved. You know, you remember from the tour that there's catwalks and there's all sorts of turns and twists and little rooms and can't get there from here, and it's a complicated section of the building. You know, rather than just say, okay, we're going to gut the whole thing and redo it, which would be extremely costly, and that's not what we're necessarily suggesting. But maybe the better approach would be, and we've kind of batted it around a little bit, is okay, a new building that we know we can build now adjacent to it, and then some select renovations. So my hope is from this meeting with Al Carney that, one, that
he's definitely shown interest in working with us on this project, and he has had interest for over a decade in helping to get something accomplished in this regard. So working with him to kind of help define the scope of what may be a practical approach to a renovation and expansion for this, and get to a point where in the next really 4 weeks or 5 weeks that we can come up with what we think is a fair estimate of what design costs would be for that. So my hope is that we are long range is meeting again on January 4th. We scheduled a meeting right after the holidays so we could again talk about this, and I've been trying to connect with Al Carney, and finally today we were able to pin something down for tomorrow before the holidays, so I'm happy about that. So hopefully that can be a positive meeting and something can come out of that where we can discuss it more in long range after the new year, and then be able to present it to the rest of you in terms of moving it forward.
Does anybody have any questions?
We also just went through in long range the capital budget. We had talked about
one question on the clock.
Yeah.
More for the staff. For the health classroom, does the health classroom, does she want to be adjacent to the physical education space, or could that class be in another classroom?
The class was in another part of the building at one point, and the a location near the gym, particularly near that area that we call the wrestling room, is important because she does CPR and needs to spread out into some of those bigger spaces. They do RAD training that she is a part of as well. So it's desirable to be there. Also, the health classes tend to be bigger in size because they parallel the size of the physical education classes, and therefore typical classrooms, while her classroom is an odd shape, mm-hmm. and long and narrow, in terms of number of square feet, it's bigger than many of the regular classrooms. So she definitely does want to be in that area. The other thing is that she very much needs to be in a space where she doesn't have to move from period to period, because they do a lot of research. They use the Chromebooks versus virtually every peerage has own set of Chromebooks. She has a lot of visual kinds of aids and things, and so would not be really conducive to just moving into any other classroom that might be needed. That being said, I think that if we weren't looking at some sort of renovation project and there were another large classroom somewhere else, we wouldn't say we have to build a new one, mm-hmm. just so it can be there. But timing is good, and because those two functions, phys ed and fitness and health, are connected, very much connected, that is where she does want to be.
Okay.
Preferably be in a room that doesn't have a door from the outside.
Yeah,
that
no.
People meet in every afternoon after school. But
no, after seeing the tour and all the complicated spaces and the other uses that came up, and mm-hmm. How do we accommodate everyone's mm-hmm. needs? And so that was one I was thinking. Okay, if it's like she just needs a mm-hmm. classroom, yeah. could she be in a different mm-hmm. classroom so that all these other elements mm-hmm. with the teams and the coaches' meetings and the referee changing and all that could be accommodated in a different way. But if she wants to be in the mix, then.
And refresh my memory, even with the expanded curriculum, there's still only one, we're not having two classes of health given at any time. There's always going to be one.
Yes, we have. Paula's number one budget priority is an additional teacher who would be half phys ed and half health. There will be enough space to have like one and a half teachers using the one room.
Did you have any other questions for Ray?
No.
Ray, capital, you were talking about?
Yeah, so we started talking about it at the meeting prior to last.
But last meeting, we went through kind of a full proposal for the next fiscal year. And when you take out kind of some placeholders for big ticket items like the Plymouth River window project that's been in there as a placeholder, and feasibility and construction money for a potential Hawk project, the number is, I think, a very reasonable one.
Between 1.3 and 1.4.
Including?
With or without those things?
Without those.
They wouldn't be funded through the capital budget.
Right.
Right.
I did those updates, and I just don't remember the exact number. But
yeah, I actually think it was it's a little over 1.1 when you take out those.
And that includes the technology that we always have in there?
Yeah, well, we'll have to wait and see what the revision is, but it's in that ballpark. Bless you.
Right, there were some adjustments, yeah.
After you guys meet on the 4th, if you iron some of those things out, just make sure we get in our packet for the 11th, the 7th?
Yeah, we John was going to revise it based on our discussions, and then, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, once that. Any questions for Ray in long-range planning? So the good news is I've received some feedback from people very excited about PRS Windows, Hawk. I've also, where people want us to really move forward. And I've also have some people saying, you know, are we really ready for these things? So the good thing about that is we've caught people's attention. And as we continue to move forward, this is the only opportunity we have to speak as a group, you know, to share questions. So any comment that comes to mind, express it. Any thought? You know, obviously, and Ray, I forgot to commend you and your group for the walk around, because that was after our December 7th meeting. You guys did a great job on that, and you guys seem to be long-range planning, and John Ferris, you guys seem to be doing a great job of continuing moving this process along. But if anyone has questions, let us know. I did, as you saw there with Ray, we have to make sure that everyone's on the same page and knows the history, because a lot of times people might just say to you, hey, are things moving along too quickly? And we talked about the windows. They've been since 05. You could make an argument, as you learned when we did the tour, that the Health and Wellness Center, now Hawk, there was discussions of that back in 98 and 2000. So everyone has a different opinion. It's no one's right, no one's wrong, but these things have been on the table. And the good thing is whatever we decide, we're just trying to educate people. We're trying to tell them the process, what we're thinking, and we'll continue moving along. And at the end of the day, if the town of Hingham is not ready, so be it. But I do feel it's one of our responsibilities to keep these dialogues going. So if you have any questions, let any of us know. But we have a meeting on the 11th. But if anyone has thoughts of this stuff, can you carve out some time in the budget meetings? So let us know, and we'll possibly pop that in. So
yeah, I mean, Annie, I think it's important for folks to know that. You know, they hear about all these things that we're talking about doing at the same time, and they say, well, wait a minute, that's a lot. But you have to understand, there's the school department and the rest of the town, and you take the two, and they're about equal in size in terms of amount of budget. We're actually much larger when you take into account, you know, the number of buildings, the number of employees, and all those things. So it's almost impossible to say, all right, we'll just pick one thing and pursue this one thing at a time. Because you pick one thing, okay, what is that? Is that the PRS windows? Is that the Hawk project? What is it? You pick one thing, and then the other five schools don't move along, right? All the schools have to, and there's, you know, things tugging at all times. And we found, you know, during the East project, during the middle school project, during the high school athletic project, every time something comes along, something else gets bumped, something else gets, you know, prioritized and kicked down the road. And there's a point where, particularly with the PRS windows, you know, even I think 2 years ago voted not to pursue it then, because I didn't think it was the right time. I think it's now a better time. You know, I think we've talked it through, we've made some decisions with respect to Foster, with respect to PRS, and now it's a better time to move forward with it. You know, you also have to look at the overall town financial picture, and I don't think you can look at the last few years and say that there's really been any concern about where we've been and where we're heading. Now, certainly the future is not completely certain, but it does look positive. So I think it's important to look at all of the things, talk about them, make decisions to move forward or not, and then let the town decide.
Yeah.
Right.
And I think one thing, and Dr. Gallo is very good at saying this, when in terms to prioritize, because when I do talk with Dr. Gallo, I always say to her, you hear us talk about this. We want to make sure these priorities are also in her vision. And I will speak for you on this one real quickly. We always have, with a school system this big, you're always going to have multiple balls in the air. And we have to work on it. But if you would like to elaborate, Dr. Gallo, feel free.
Well, I think the multiple balls in the air is our life. But also, we don't always control the timelines for projects. And the Plymouth River windows would be a good example. I mean, we could put in a request, an application, not here until next November, not able to get to a town meeting then for funding until subsequent to that. So not all the projects take the same amount of time to complete, and we don't control many of the aspects of those projects. We control putting in a request. We control advocating for and getting out information so people can make a reasonable decision. But if we continue to defer and then for some reason a project is not going to get funded the first time, which could happen, sometimes we have to go back more than once for a project, then you can be 4 and 5 and more years down the road. So we have to get our oar in the water, so to speak, and then the decision will be the town's. But if we don't start, we can always start, and we might be delayed in construction, but if we don't at least apply or put a warrant item in, then we automatically have to wait a year because there's only one town meeting for most.
Well, I think also, to be clear, make me sure I got this date right. Hypothetically, if we were to continue just moving forward with Hawk, let's just say Hawk, we would go to the town meeting possibly this April for feasibility money. We would then go, if it continued to move forward, so that's April of 16, if it continued to go more, you would go for full funding April of 17. And with renovations with the school there, it might, in theory, not even open till September of 17? Or would that be September of 18?
Yeah. I don't know. I think it depends on what the scope ends up being. And, you know, if you're talking about limited interior renovations and then a new outside building, maybe it could all be, all the interior stuff gets done in the summertime and the exterior takes longer, but that won't interfere with anything. I don't know.
But I'm just trying to point out that
we're
January 16, basically.
It's at least a 2-year process, right. I think.
Okay. So that's what I'm just trying to articulate with people when we talk about these things. And again, whatever the town decides, that's fine. But we want to make sure that we continually discuss this in open, and if people have questions, let us know, and we'll go from there.
Well, and there's a lot of factors that go into these decisions. I know folks have said, well, wait, before we do anything, we ought to do a new master plan, and we ought to finish an enrollment study. And okay, we do need to do those things, but I don't think that an enrollment study is going to tell us that, you know, whether we have one student at Plymouth River or we have, you know, 575 or 475, whatever the number is, the windows need to be done. Right, and increased students aren't going to change that factor. The Hawk project, I think, has very little to do with enrollment. Actually, I mean, it's health curriculum driven, not just the change, but existing health curriculum. It's physical education curriculum driven, and it's also support of our athletic program. So it's all three of those, and whether it's 1,200 students or it's 1,400 students. You know, three sports teams, one sport team, new health curriculum or old health curriculum, we have poor health and fitness facilities in this area that need to be improved. It's bottom line.
And also, we always have to have our ear open to what's happening on the town hall side, because not only do we not make all the decisions, but we aren't operating in a vacuum as well. So there are needs there, and some of those are uncertain in terms of timing. So my feeling is we should continue to move ahead, do what we need to do to keep our our oar in the water and then be willing to react to whatever the town decides, and we always do, and we make the best of it.
So everyone remember, January 4th of 16, long-range planning's meeting. Ray clearly said that they're continuing, the group is continuing to define their scope. Anyone with suggestions, reach out to Ray or reach out to John and Ray to provide that information so they can discuss at their long-range planning meeting. And I think that, you know, that can only help their arguments. Other than that, Merry Christmas, Happy New Year's, Happy Holidays. I'll take a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.